I, John, was on the island that is called Patmos. I was in the spirit on the Lord's Day, and I heard behind me a loud voice. To the angel of the church in Pergamum write, I know your works, and where you dwell, where Satan's throne is. And you hold fast to my name, and did not deny my faith, even in the days in which Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was killed among you, where Satan dwells.
Today all that's left of Pergamum are ruins. But when the Apostle John wrote his letter to the church there, it was one of the most influential cities in the Roman Empire.
Pergamum had a unique status that was different than any other city because it was the political center. And it was from there that all of the rulings were made, which affected the whole of Asia Minor.
The city's Acropolis rivaled Athens, and its library was the second largest in the ancient world, with a collection so great that the Roman general Mark Antony presented it as a wedding gift to Cleopatra.
At the end of the first century, Pergamum was a thriving city. So why does the book of Revelation call it the dwelling place of Satan? The answer lies in the ruins of the city's temples.
On one side, it was a very beautiful city. But on the flip side, it was one of the darkest, eeriest cities in the whole Roman Empire.
The people of Pergamum were known as the temple keepers of Asia. The city had three temples dedicated to the worship of the Roman emperor, another for the goddess Athena, and the great altar of Zeus, the king of the Greek gods. Many scholars believe this altar is the throne of Satan, mentioned in the book of Revelation.
That word throne was first used to describe a chair that was used in a personal private residence, and it was the chair for the lord of the house, the master of the house. The very fact that Jesus would use that word in this verse means Satan felt at home there. He sat on a throne there. It was his territory. He was the master of that house.
The city also had a healing center called the Asclepion. It was built in honor of the Greek serpent god Asclepios.
In the first century, this was a cross between a hospital and a health spa, where patients could get everything from mud baths to major surgery. Even the emperors came all the way from Rome to be treated here. But this was no ordinary doctor's visit.
If you were a terminal patient, then you were not allowed to go into the Asclepion. And these Asclepion priests didn't want anyone hearing somebody had died in the Asclepion. And in fact, there was a huge sign just above the official entrance to the Asclepion which said, death is not permitted here. So the only way you were going to get in to begin with is if they knew you were going to live.
Patients entered through this underground tunnel. Then they drank a sedative and slept here in the dormitories, while non-poisonous snakes crawled around them all night. They were told that the serpent god Asclepios would speak to them in their dreams and give them a diagnosis.
It was believed that the snakes actually carried the healing power of Asclepios. And if a snake slithered across you while you were sleeping at night, that was a divine sign that healing power was coming to you.
The next morning, the patients told their dreams to the priests who prescribed their treatments. Finally, the patients made clay sculptures of the body parts that needed healing and offered them to Asclepios.
The people of Pergamum worshipped a myriad of Greek and Roman gods, but when Christianity arrived with the belief in just one god, the city's pagan priests went on the attack, and their most famous victim was a man named Antipas.
In the book of Revelation, Jesus called Antipas my faithful martyr. He was the bishop of Pergamum, ordained by the Apostle John. And his faith got the attention of the priests of Asclepius, who complained to the Roman governor in Pergamum. The priests testified that demons appeared to them in their dreams and told them that the prayers of Antipas were driving them out of the city.
He had cast out so many devils, that the demons, the spirits, had been complaining to pagans, you've got to do something about this Antipas.
Antipas was ordered to offer a sacrifice of wine and incense to a statue of the Roman emperor and declare that the emperor was Lord and God. He refused.
If you reject the divinity of the emperor, it's the equivalent of rejecting the city of Rome. And believers were killed for this.
Antipas was sentenced to death on the altar of Zeus.
Most of that altar survives today, and surrounding it are some of the world's most famous marble friezes. They portray the battle between the Greek gods and the giants.
At the top of the altar was a hollow bronze bull designed for human sacrifice.
They would take the victim, place him inside the bull. They would tie him in such a way that his head would go into the head of the bull, then light a huge fire under the bull. And as the fire heated the bronze, the person inside the bull would slowly begin to roast to death. And as the victim would begin to moan and would begin to cry out in pain, his cries would go through all of the pipes which were in the head of the bull, so it seemed to make the bull come alive.
Even in the midst of the flames, Antipas died praying for his church.
A few years later, the Apostle John wrote the book of Revelation, mentioning the death of Antipas on this very spot. Here in Pergamum, all that's left is the foundation. Today, the altar of Zeus is more than 1,000 miles away.
In the 19th century, German engineers dismantled the altar and took it to Berlin. The so-called throne of Satan went on display in the city's Pergamon Museum in 1930, just in time to inspire one of the most brutal dictators the world has ever seen.